Blackstone Audio presents Hostile Witness, a Kate Ford Mystery by Leigh Adams. This book is read by Suzanne Elise Freeman. 1. A man stood in the middle of the road, just inside the perimeter, and there was something wrong with him. There was something wrong with him, but Kate's head was throbbing so badly she couldn't begin to think of what it was. She tried all the things that she usually did when she found herself in this position, and found, also as usual, that none of them worked. The man was wearing black, and even at this distance, she could see that his earlobes were overly extended, as if he had done something to them that stretched them out. Was that what was wrong with him? Maybe he'd had those thick rings in them and then had taken them out. She adjusted her sunglasses. It wasn't a very bright day, but it didn't matter. She snaked her hand into her bag and grabbed her healing stone. After checking to make sure there was no traffic on the road, Kate carefully pressed down on the brakes, then closed her eyes and counted to 10. When she opened her eyes again, she thought the man had disappeared. Then she saw him, another 3 feet along, heading for the open maw of the parking garage. That was wrong, too. This wasn't a pedestrian area. There were no sidewalks. There was nowhere to walk here from. And if you did walk here from somewhere, you wouldn't go through the garage entrance. You would go around to the side and enter the building at the front door. It had been a long drive in from home, made worse by the throbbing inside her skull that just would not quit. Everything around her looked sharper and more detailed than it should have. Everything hurt. The man was wearing a black suit that looked as if it cost $5,000. His shirt was so white it caused glare. His tie was so black it looked painted on. Under the suit jacket was a vest. Also black. Kate found herself wondering hysterically if the man was some kind of a very expensive undertaker. The car swung left as if of its own volition. She had been driving by instinct. She hadn't had to pay attention. Deep memory had been paying attention for her. She jerked her mind back to the task at hand and stopped at the gate to present her identification. The interior of the garage was dark, silent, and still. She climbed carefully up the levels until she found one that was nearly vacant and pulled into an empty space. Then she turned off the car and waited until the engine noises stopped. It was cool and dark in here. Nothing was moving. Nothing was happening. Kate closed her eyes and put her forehead down on the steering wheel. Her headache began to subside. Her nausea, nausea she hadn't realized she had, began to subside too. It was as if she'd been engulfed by a tide, and the tide had turned, and Kate gave it up. She'd spent most of her adult life trying to describe these episodes to everybody from lovers to doctors and back again. It never worked. When she was in the middle of an episode, she could barely speak. When she was clear of them, she couldn't really remember. She thought back to her son, Jack, and the crazy fight they'd had this morning. The fight should have set her off, but it hadn't. Her head hadn't started to throb until hours later, when a traffic light had switched from red to green so suddenly it had made her shudder. Kate took her keys out of the ignition and shoved them in her jacket pocket. She got out of the car, locked up, and looked around. The man had been walking toward the opening of the garage, but of course he hadn't come up here, if he had ever existed at all. 2. The Almador Corporation was one of those businesses that Kate used to make fun of when she was younger, and that her son, Jack, made fun of now. Its premises were bland from the outside, but that was the problem, wasn't it? They were too bland. There was no way to tell, from the building's front elevation or from the parking garage entrance and exits, exactly what Almodóvar did. Nor could you form much of an impression once you got into the building. There was an expanse of blank walls and doors with people's names on them. The doors always seemed to be shut, even in the middle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.